welcome a well-known radio astronomer and radio scientist, Professor Ananthakrishnan, to the great hub of knowledge, IIT BHU. Today we are blessed to have Professor Ananthakrishnan here to deliver a lecture titled Acharya Jagdish Chandra Bose, the genius ahead of his time. Sir Jagdish Chandra Bose is one of the most prominent first Indian scientists who proved by experimentation that both animals and plants share much in common. His work and theories will always be inspiration for us, and it is our pleasure today to talk about him more. So to start this program, may I first request Professor Jeet sir to deliver the welcome address and say a few words.
So, it's a very odd system for me. Anyway, so it's a great pleasure for all of us that Professor Ananthakrishnan will deliver a lecture on Sir J.C. Bose. And I'm a great fan of Sir J.C. Bose. And to be honest, whenever I get an opportunity to deliver any lecture, whether it's microphotonics, maybe on terrestrialology, maybe something, I always try to tribute something to Sir J.C. Bose, because I think that he is one of the most brilliant scientists India has ever produced. Although he has not got any Nobel Prize, but his contribution was beyond doubt much above of many things. So I hope that we will come to know many new things about him, about his research, through Sir Professor Ananthakrishnan. So with these few words, I would like to welcome Professor Ananthakrishnan to deliver the starting lecture. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. Now I would like to call upon Dr. Ananthakrishnan, Dr. Shyam Kamal sir, Dr. Somak Bhattacharya, Dr. Smriti Dwivedi, and Dr. S.P. Singh sir for the garland ceremony.
Why are you can we listen to this? Talking about the garland.
Now I would like to call upon Dr. Shyam Kamal to say a few words.
Very good evening, all of you. So it is our pleasure that Professor Ananthakrishnan is here, and he is going to give us generalized talk about Jagdish Chandra Bose. Actually, from childhood onward, I am hearing about this genius guy, because several times my father was telling about him and trying to motivate me that you can do research, means you can take research as a career. And I think that in order to become a successful researcher means we need some kind of motivation. So motivation is always required in order to continue our research. So I think that taking this talk means we are further motivated and try to do some kind of a small contribution to this country or this world. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir, for your wonderful speech. May I now request Dr. Somak Bhattacharya to introduce the speaker.
Well, good afternoon, everyone. So today, 31st October, we are exactly 1 month away from the birth anniversary of Acharya Jagadish Chandra Bose and 160th, right? So we are having amongst us Professor Subra Ananthakrishnan. So just I am reading out his bio data. An internationally and nationally known radio astronomer and radio scientist, Subramaniam Ananthakrishnan had a brilliant academic career and got his BSc honors from Presidency College, Kolkata, B.Tech and M.Tech from Institute of Radio Physics and Electronics from Calcutta University, and later his PhD in Radio Astronomy Physics from Tata Institute of Fundamental Research and University of Bombay in 1976. He was a Jesse Bose National Science Talent Scholar during 1961 to 66 and an academic member of TIFR Mumbai since 1966, and was deeply involved in the construction, commissioning and operation of two major radio astronomy facilities known as UTI Radio Telescope in 1970 and the Giant Meteorwave Radio Telescope, that is GMRT, in 1999. He was the project scientist and head of electronics and control systems of GMRT during 1989 to 2000, and commissioned GMRT in 2001 and was its observatory director till 2004, and retired from TIFR as a senior professor in 2007. Since then, he is an adjunct professor in the Electronic Science Department of Pune University, now known as Savitribhai Phule Pune University. He was a DAE BRNS Raja Ramanna Fellow during 2007-12 and held an INSA Senior Scientist Fellowship from 2013-16. He is an INSA Honorary Scientist from January 2017. He teaches MSc students of the Electronic Science Department, Antennas, Electromagnetics and Communication Systems. Because of his extensive engineering and scientific expertise, he got involved as a reviewer, chairman and member of many major astronomy projects such as UVIT of AstroSat, AstroSat itself, DOT 3.6 meter optical telescope and so on. An elected fellow of all the major national science academies of India, Professor Ananthakrishnan was given the prestigious INSA International Vainu Bappu Memorial Award 2010 for his outstanding contribution in setting up the large UTI radio telescope and the GMRT telescope and making extensive observations of radio sources using the telescope. He was elected as the Vice President of International Radio Science Union URSI during 2011-17 after having been the chairman of one of its commission, Commission J, during 2008-11. He was a member of the first board of Kashmir Central University. He is a jury member of the INSA Inspire Faculty Award program in physical science for the past 6 years. He was elected as a fellow of URSI in 2017. He is credited with authorship of or the order of 150 papers in national and international publications with high citation. So with a very big hand of applause, I want to welcome Professor Ananda.
Okay, so really, this works. This works. Yeah? This one, I can move, right? Which one? Well, this is there. This is there. Oh, that is working. And movement is by this. This one. Okay. Good. Yes. Okay. Yeah, some water. Water is always useful. So it's a great pleasure for me to be here. Can you hear me?
Yes, sir.
Okay. It's not my intention to give you a big fund up. It's my intention to sort of motivate you and inspire you on what we really need in this country, from whatever experience I have. Now I think I have something like close to almost 60 years in the beginning. They are pretty old. So whatever I have learned in the last so many decades, having been associated with various activities in India. So some aspects of that I want to share with you. And I think the starting point is this great man, Jagdish Chandra Bose. I tell my class students that whenever you get up in the morning, you are a kumsoer, you are a bhakta, you can pray to Brahma, Vishnu, Shiva, or even maybe Jesus or Allah, it's all okay. But along with that, you also please pray to Maxwell, Faraday, and Jagdish Chandra Bose. Okay, because these are people who have created a new world for us. Because, of course, the great discoveries of Michael Faraday, that electricity and magnetism are one and the same. And one follows the other, and they're inseparable, that opened a whole new phase in our civilization. And it, of course, fell upon Maxwell to go to him as a young person, I think roughly of 22 years or 23 years or something like that, and go and tell Michael Faraday that you are only saying, but I am going to prove it. Okay? And Faraday is supposed to have said, Faraday is supposed to have said, what? What are you talking about? I don't understand. So Maxwell went back and then he said, I'll see you after 10, 15 days. And then when he went back, he had basically those four equations. It's a now formed. Because of Hindsight's role later, and he made it much better. But the basic four equations, which are combining Faraday's laws, Ampere's laws, and Maxwell's own contribution of extension to Ampere's law, that was basically there. And the story goes that Faraday left, and he said, my life job is done. Now I can go. Okay, that is all. However, look at this whole beauty of it. Nobody believed Maxwell. Even after he wrote this equation, nobody believed him. And he took the findings of Hertz and he showed that the electromagnetic waves can be propagated, spark generator, and then finding production and detection of that. That people started believing that yes, electricity and magnetism is now combined. So progress in science or in technology doesn't come very easily. It takes a long time. And there is much to be learned because of that. And in this country particularly, we have been very unfortunate. Very unfortunate because of maybe, I don't know why, maybe 1,000 years of some kind of colonialism or not that if you are a free India, you will do much better. You can see every day in the newspaper, it doesn't fill you with great happiness. No. You feel rather sad the way politicians are doing the country. But anyway, there is a problem. There is, you must understand that it is not easy to make progress in science. And it was extremely difficult at the time of the mission of life. So with that, I want to start, but the The first thing is, many of you may have heard of Jagdish Bose, but I am often surprised that a large number of youngsters who have not heard of him, and he has everything to do with Varanasi University. Look at this. 1916, he delivered the inaugural address entitled From the Wise to the Unwise at the foundation of the Varanasi University. 1925, he delivered the convocation address at the Varanasi University. And 1933, he was conferred the honorary degree of BSc by Varanasi University. So he had a very strong association with BHU. And my own very simple association with BHU is that my father is also a student of Varanasi University. He passed out from here as an electrical mechanical engineer in 1934. And so he has described to me Madan Mohan Malaviya ji in great detail. He used to feel so proud about being a student of BHU. So I feel very nostalgic in coming here and talking to you about science and technology. So we should know about such a person. So before that, of course, very quickly, lest there is somebody in the audience who is not into electromagnetic spectrum. It goes all the way from a range of energies from gamma rays to X-rays to UV to visible to infrared radio. So electromagnetic waves travel like ocean waves. As you all know, energy of radiation depends upon the distance between first and first of the waves from the wavelength. Lambda is small, the energy of wave is high. And since gamma rays are the shortest, they are the highest in energy. And so electromagnetic spectrum, it is very relevant to the entire talk because we will be coming again and again into this. Okay? And we will be covering from one end to the other end, almost. So we have the entire thing, I don't have to go through all this, but we have from very high frequencies or very low frequency here to very high frequency there, very low wavelength to very low energy to very high energy, and very high wavelength to very low wavelength, all of them. And that is the spectrum which we are seeing. The key aspect of this is that this one, I think, yeah. So the visual window and the radio window, that's the only key point which I want to emphasize, which is that this is only 1:2. This is from around 400 nanometer to 800 nanometer. I used to say, mug up this number when the age of 17, and that's how I got the JVMSTS scholarship. Somebody asked me, do you know what is the wavelength of light? I said 380 to 760 nanometer. I said, what? You know all these things? Okay, this fellow seems to be good enough. So, this 380 to 760, whereas we are going to talk about something like 0.1 millimeter to kilometers, which is the radio window. So, all this area, covering all this. So, that is part of what J.C. Bose did, and we will extend that to beyond him. So, Bose was really the first, as sir said, he was the first scientist in India to bring modern science into the country. Okay, because he immediately followed, he listened to a lecture by Lloyd, I think, and was it Lloyd? You remember that? Lloyd, in Royal Society, about the electromagnetic waves, about the Maxwell's equations, and about Hertz's discovery, and put his mind to it, and he finally came up with the invention of the 5 millimeter to 25 millimeter wavelength electromagnetic waves, which is microwaves and lower microwaves. And then of course he did this, as people have already said, made phenomenal discoveries in plant physiology and biophysics. So when I was 17 years old, I won this JVNSTS scholarship. And actually, that is how I ended up seeing the Bose Institute first. And therefore, I went, Bose used to call this as the temple of science. So he had built it with a lot of money he had. It's a great big story. His father was a very generous philanthropist. He was, and he spent all his money educating people. But then he was in great debt by the time he was very old. And Jagdish Bose had to earn money to pay back all the debts. But apparently a few years before his father's death, he was freed of all debt. So he died as a free man. So Jagdish Bose really was a man of great ethics and honor and a man of integrity. So he was born, as he says, November 30, 1858, almost 160 years ago. Took his mathematical tripods in London and joined as a lecturer at Presidency College, Kolkata. And when he came back with a great recommendation from nobody less than Lord Raleigh. Okay, and so the Viceroy of India was Babel, I think. Babel or somebody. Yeah, Viceroy of India was very impressed and he said, make him a professor. But when he came to Calcutta, the principal of the college, Presidency College, he said, but you are an Indian. How can you be on par with the Englishman? He said, I will give you half the salary. Okay. And Bose said, I will accept to be a lecturer, but I will not accept the salary. But oh, okay. Sorry. Either you give me full salary, or I don't take the salary. So for 3 years, he fought. He said, I don't want the salary. At the end of 3 years, they had to pay him with retrospective effect. Fortunately, nowadays I'm told that even the seventh pay commission is not retrospective money. So all the teachers, they're already, they are feeling very, very upset from various places. So anyway, Bose made a spectacular discovery of producing a radiation of wavelength of the order of 5 millimeters, and he showed that these waves could travel through the walls and windows and all that. And this was, of course, 150 years before the idea of 5G smartphones, which would be using these millimeter waves. To Jagdish Bose, the world owes micro and millimeter waves, really. And Bose's idea was that one should generate short waves. That is the key idea. You know, the rest is all technology and basic hard work. But the key idea was that he actually wanted to see whether we can produce waves which are longer than light wavelength, but they will produce still reflection, refraction, diffraction, scattering. Because then that would prove Maxwell. Because Maxwell said that everything is the same. Electromagnetic waves, they not only are over light waves, but they're also, first of all, the greatest contribution of Maxwell is that he said velocity of light is equal to a fixed number, and it's 3 into 10 to the power of 10, something approximately to that. So, but once he said that the electromagnetic spectrum is all over, then it doesn't have any boundaries, then Bose wanted to prove that. And that's how he got into this. And so, whether it has all these reflection, diffraction, polarization properties, this will conclusively prove that all these invisible waves belong to the same family. And this confirms that the electromagnetic spectrum is similar at all frequencies. So that was the objective. And so we saw that right from ULF, which is only 3 hertz to 30 hertz or so, it goes all the way to terahertz. So one can study the interaction of these radio waves with other radio waves, as well as geophysical and astrophysical media, man-made structures, and biological system. And that's what we are doing today with all this. So he invented for this purpose what is called a spark transmitter. A spark transmitter, I will not go into the details of spark transmitter, it is not relevant anymore. But it is only consisting of an inductance and a capacitance. And so in charge there, and when the charge is sufficiently high, if you bring the two wires close through two spheres, then there is spark. So you charge and charge and charge using a battery or whatever. And then it produces a spark, and that produces damped electromagnetic waves. Okay, because any spark produces radiation, like a scooter. Well, scooter is parked in front of your house, and it starts, you can sort of see it in the TV. Not these days very much, because we only get dish TV. Okay, so that has to go all the way up and down, so it doesn't work. But previously, when we used to have Yagi antennas and all that for receiving TV, then every time a scooter went by, we suddenly Vaishnavana disappeared. So because this is some 30 years ago. There was no Aishwarya Rai and others. Shah Rukh Khan was not there. So we used to see that. So this was, therefore, the spark transmitter and more importantly, the receiver. How do you receive? Because these are the days of no amplitude modulation, no FM, nothing. So how do you receive an alternating electromagnetic wave? Okay. You need a detector, correct? So today we have, of course, for a few paisas you can get diode detector. But there was no diode detector. Nobody knew that there is a possibility of producing a one directional, you know, detection. So that you can cut the electromagnetic wave into half. So you get unidirectional wave. So that was the whole trick. That is the whole trick of diode. And so the diode, we don't talk very much about it. But the discovery of diode is a fundamental progress which has been made in electronic devices. He will agree with me. Okay. So that is what he did. So what he did was basically here, today we know that we have a metal and then we have an intrinsic semiconductor and then we have a metal. And so this combination was produced by him by having an iron and a mercury vapor and an iron. And by combining this and by adjusting with screws, he produced a device by which you could make this pass through the electromagnetic wave. When it passes through this, it detects and only the top of this comes out. And so you have got unidirectional DC. Okay. Some kind of a DC. Okay. So all it had to do was to move a relay finally. And so that relay was used as a Morse code. So it had the whole idea of Marconi also was that he didn't know what to do. So you had alternating current which is detected like this, and then that makes the relay go for a short length or a long length or nothing. So that is Morse code. So short spacing, long spacing, and nothing. And this is how you send, you know, a dot 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 dash dot dash. That is Morse code. Okay. So this is what Marconi also did. But it is said that Marconi got the idea from Bose's detector, and that has been controversial forever. Half the people say that Marconi never accepted, but I read recently that Marconi did accept it, and he paid. There is supposed to be some chapter of a book where he said about one page on how much of a contribution Bose made for making his detector work. Okay, so. It is Marconi's grandson had come to Calcutta some 15 years ago. And he is also supposed to have said, yes, I know that my grandpa agreed that J.C. Bose's contribution was very important for him. But all that doesn't absolve the Nobel Committee of the sin which they committed by not giving J.C. Bose as part of the Nobel Prize. So anyway, he was able to do this. He was able to produce a spark and he was able to produce an arrangement by which you could detect that spark. That was all that was required. And then this could propagate through the wall. And that is, I think, sort of an accident. Because maybe he did not know, because it will go. But maybe he discovered it by accident that it goes. So the story goes that he transmitted the waves through the body of the lieutenant governor of Bengal. Nowadays, if you do such things, then you will be considered a terrorist and you will be inside the body. It will be jail without bail. So he didn't get into that. But it exploded a mine placed in a closed room. Can you imagine? For classifying one as a terrorist, what else you mean? He is exploding a mine. So anyway, this apparatus was shown later in Royal Institution in London. And this is the apparatus with goes there. And so when it was shown in London, the most important thing was that till then, till 1897, the ships in the sea, they had to rely on the fire signals from the shore. There was no way of signaling a ship which is there in the ocean. And there was no microwave or anything like that. So immediately people understood that this has got a tremendous importance. So they said that transmitted signals to a distance of nearly a mile, and herein lies the first and obvious and exceedingly valuable application of this new theoretical marvel. He says this alone will be a priceless gift to mankind. Because they said now ships can detect where is the shore. Okay. Because of the signals which are coming back and forth. So this was, but he said, I have nothing to do with all these things. No, I am interested in reflection and scattering. And that is the great downfall of discipline. Because he should have had the brains to say that this is a good discovery, so let me patent it. No. Have you heard of the slogan of Professor Mashalkar? An eminent scientist of India, he says, patent or perish. So it is not published or perish. It is for professors. It is patent or perish. Okay. So that is the way in which it was even in 1900. People had started taking patents. And so Margudi was very, very clever. He said, I don't know Bose was. All this. He did not allow anyone else to make a patent on his behalf. There were people who were Swami Vivekananda tried his very best to make Bose apply for a patent. Even Swami Vivekananda was a more practical man than many of us. So anyway, this is the whole thing is a fantastic device. We reproduced this about 10 years ago, 2005 General Assembly in Delhi, and we made it work. So we had a tiny spark transmitter which was generating this, and then we had a detector. And we could show that the galvanometer moves, and that in fact that is there in GMRT. I don't know whether it works now. So, Bose said radiating box was portable. The one I have been using is 7 inch by 6 inch by 4 inch. We use this to exhibit generation of 5 to 25 millimeter waves. So, this was the transmitter, and that was the receiver of Jesse Bose, which we had reproduced more recently. But apart from this, generating polarized radio waves at short wavelength, Bose also discovered a spiral spin coherer, which is what I was saying, which is a diode, which I will tell you a little bit more, somewhat like a metal semiconductor metal junction, and a sensitive point contact detector, hemispherical dielectric lens pairs for measuring the refractive index of sulfur, a variable millimeter wave double crystal attenuator, polarizer and a cylindrical diffraction grating that could be used as a high resolution antenna in millimeter and some millimeter wavelength. So he actually covered millimeter and some millimeter wavelength. Okay, in 1895. And we are producing these things 100 years from then. Only recently, in the last 10, 15 minutes, we have started making these things, which I will talk about later. So this was a spring, what is called a spring coherer. It functions like a very low efficiency diode rectifier. So actually, a replica was produced, and when people tried to reproduce, it worked like a diode, but it had very poor output. It did about 10 microamps for a 480 microamp peak to peak alternating current signal. So it does work. This is a normal diode. This is a normal diode these days. Okay. And this is the diode curve which is produced by following Bose's model. This is the famous point contact detector, which was the true diode. This was made, I think, sometimes in 1904 or 1905 or something like that. Do you know?
1897. Around 1894 or something like that.
Okay. Yeah. So it was years and years ahead of time.
Basically, the structure, I guess, was something before that. Just put a linear flap.
Yes.
And just made a gear, fasten you, and just push you. So then it demonstrated this thing that is in one way, it is way convey from compared to the
other side. Compared to the other side. Yeah. So this is a dual prism attenuator. The whole thing works by adjusting the screw. By the screw, you move this very nicely. This is a micrometer screw. And so you can move this, and then it becomes an air attenuator for millimeter waves. And this is the produced one in 1995, I think, by the National Radio Astronomy Observatory. And this is actually used in the National Radio Astronomy Observatory telescope today. So this was simply a copy, exact copy of J.C. Bose. This is exactly identical to this. There are three or four of them here. Okay. And these screws are much better because today's milling machines are much better quality. So that's all. There is no other difference between what Bose made and what has been produced. He produced a beautiful polarizer. He got out of what is called the Bradshaw timetable. No? The timetable is the Indian railway timetable used to be about this thick. Not this thick, about half of this thick. And he interspersed between the paper thin foils. And he showed that it acts like a polarizer for millimeter waves. Very clever, I would say. So the key takeaway from all this is that he had a very creative mind. You know? So he used jute, paraffin oil, so galena, okay, and paper, tin foil, all these commonplace items to show something which is extremely sophisticated. Okay, that is why the whole cleverness lies. And when we talk of this so-called Make in India program, you know, we are living on some what we really need are very clever ideas from young fellows like you. Oh, we are fossils. So we really need great ideas from you guys, which are original and which understands the today's science and technology, but creatively thinks of ideas which are breathtaking and which can really produce, you know, revolution. Because we have to start asking very ruthlessly, we have to start asking the question, why are we not discovering, you know, Gerard's oscillators? Why are we not discovering medical apparatus which are being discovered in the West? The basic fundamentals are not changing. So why is it that every discovery has to come from somebody from Italy or from Germany or from Japan or from South Korea or even from China? Okay. I can tell you in very practical terms, I have been a professor in China for short periods of time. They are more intelligent than any of them. In fact, they are less intelligent than the average bright Indian girls or boys. It is simply that they are very focused and they are putting a tremendous amount of work, hard work into
it.
Very hard working. Okay. If you put 10 Chinese together, it is extremely different from 10 Indians today. They will produce, we will destroy.
In Indians cannot survive also.
This is our problem. So first of all, please, before you get out of Varanasi University, learn teamwork. Okay, without that teamwork, we are not going to survive. Okay, Nobel Prizes are not being produced by C.V. Raman holding a lens and all that. No. They are being produced by teams of people. Everybody is adding a little bit, and you are only seeing one guy. When David Wineland comes for the Asia Pacific Radio Science Conference, he is going to say exactly the same thing because I have heard his talk. He says, what have I done? I haven't done anything. This was all done by all these guys. I was just floating at the top. Okay, which is true. So this is what we have to understand. Apparently, Bodhisattva asked, अरे हमारे वैज्ञानिक लोग कुछ प्रोड्यूस नहीं करते हैं आजकल तो आई हर्ड इट वेरी रिसेंटली इट सीम्स ही सेड फ्रॉम समबडी हु वाज देयर हु वाज सिटिंग देयर ओके ही हैड गॉन टू सी द पीएम अकॉर्डिंग टू पीएम सेड देन हमारे पीएचडी स्टूडेंट्स तो यहाँ से वहाँ कॉपी करते हैं और पीएचडी बना देते हैं इससे क्या होगा. So this is what our thinking of our political masters is. Okay, so unless we also think very hard and start producing very creatively, and we can show deliverance, we are not going to have any great credibility in the country. That is what it is coming to. So all the grants are drying up. So anyway, apart from developing the world's first horn antenna and a rectangular waveguide for receiving the millimeter waves, he also developed the first millimeter wave link in 1897. Modern version is the 5G that will revolutionize the communications in the coming years. He showed that different materials selectively absorb millimeter waves. In summary, considering the social milieu in which he worked, he was well ahead of his time and can be called the father of radio science. The later review said that Bose's technical virtuosity was quite remarkable. Microwave generators, detectors, waveguides, horn antennas, lens antennas, mirrors, two prism direction couplers, polarimeters, spectrometers, all the paraphernalia he designed and developed it himself. He has been called the father of microwave analog optics for very good reason. Nor was he less a pioneer in making solid-state detectors to construct these. He discovered the phenomena of doping, as Sir said. Clearly, he was at least 50 years ahead of his time, is what Neville Mott is supposed to have said in 1977 when he got the Nobel Prize and he was giving the Nobel lecture. Okay, this was 50 years before. J.C. Bose. Okay. So he was one of those Indian saints, not scientists. He was a kind of a saint who believed in this Loka Samasta Subramaniam and Vasudeva Kudumbakam. He really truly believed in it. and therefore it was difficult to make him apply for patents and all that. But his quasi-optic components like the dielectric lens and wire grid polarizers are now in wide use. Low-loss synthetic dielectric materials have been used to produce hard lens for millimeter waves. Similarly, commercial wire grid polarizers are available in the 200 to 2000 gigahertz band, which takes us to terahertz. NRAO made an array of dual prism attenuators for local oscillator injection at 230 gigahertz, and the 12 meter kit peak radio telescope, which we saw. And he was also prescient in stating that the atmosphere was responsible for blocking the shortwave radio radiation from the sun. It was only during mid 1940s that solar radio astronomy was born. Okay. It is not widely known that J.C. Bose was possibly the first one to fabricate an X-ray machine in India in 1895. So, albeit late, the Arsi General Assembly of 2005 in Delhi was dedicated to this great son of India. So, a question often raised in India is, why did Acharya Bose not get a Nobel Prize? He was certainly of a Nobel class. The main reason, as I said, was himself. While Marconi was a contemporary, was aggressive and marketed his transatlantic communication as a great discovery, Bose does not even want it to, chose not even to patent his discovery. And in comparison, Raman made sure that his discovery got noticed. Okay, Professor Raman was very clever. He has been discussing just before coming here. He published it, as I learned, not in current sense, which I was thinking, published in the Indian Journal of Physics. Okay, and he knew that nobody would read Indian Journal of Physics. So he made 2,000 copies of it. And he sent it to every damn scientist in the world. Okay, saying that I did this. First of all. So he established his credential. The second thing he did was even more clever. He bought a ticket for a Nobel Prize. Nobody had announced the Nobel Prize. Because it was difficult, it was 1 month journey to India or Sweden. But this gentleman had a ticket 6 months before. Okay, after that the Nobel Prize was announced. And of course he got the Nobel Prize. I don't know what he would have done. Maybe there was a cancellation possibility. Okay, nowadays it is very great cost to cancel. You cancel, no refund. You lose 75% of the money, all that comes. So Raman was very clever. So in totality, Bose was simply not interested in the commercial aspects of his discoveries. But it was not just that. It was also, as I was telling sir, it was also to do with the intellectual property rights. And Bose couldn't care less. In fact, he said that I don't care. Anybody and everybody can use it. Marconi is using it, let him use it. Big deal. Okay, so he was not bothered. Yes. Okay. And I read a book in which he writes to Rabindranath, who was his close friend, Rabindranath Tagore, who was his close friend. Can you imagine a multi-millionaire came to me and asked me after my talk in the Royal Society that please allow me to patent this. I will share half the profit with you. Can you imagine? This fellow is so greedy after money. I'm least interested in this money. This country is just full of people who are after money. That's what he writes. Three times he writes. Money. I'm sick and tired of this. So he was truly a scientist of the highest caliber and who did not believe in keeping any of these discoveries to himself. In fact, the gentleman told him, saying that please don't discuss the details. Okay, we will patent them. In the lecture, he said, no. such persons cannot survive without it. Very well done. As they say, I used to read a big advertisement when I was a child. Man plus dress is equal to personality, even more true of women. Okay. If you cannot dress well, then you are not educated. You put on, all these guys are very smartly dressed, even the girls. Instead of this, you put on some, you know, rags and all that. Even the fellow in the hotel will not allow you to even go inside. So the world is full of make-believe. So it is not sufficient that you do good work. It is also important to make everybody think that you have done good work. So there are many people who don't do good work, but they have made everybody believe that they have done good work. They are even more successful. That's marketing. Okay. So these are, well, that's the way world grows. I don't know what to do about this. But I will just close this subject with a nice quote. The wireless telegraph is not difficult to understand. The ordinary telegraph is like a very long cat. You pull the tail in New York and it moves in Los Angeles. The wireless is the same, only without the cat. And only one man can write such thing. So, okay, so we have to go much, much further. So anyway, 1950s, 60s, 70s, you have Bell Labs demonstrated long-haul communications using buried circular millimeter wave guide in advance of fiber optics, millimeter wave radio astronomy, developed high-performance components and assemblies, military radars, radio meters, advances in communications technology enhanced the industrial base. The whole thing changed, you know. Millions and millions of jobs were created, and what has happened in Bell Labs is something worth reading of these years. You know, there's a beautiful book on Bell Labs. You know, for example, Schottky, Bardeen, Bratton, how they discovered the transistors and all that. The growth of Bell Labs and its decay. A book came some 3 years ago. It's a beautiful book. I will definitely ask all of you if you can find to read it. It traces how discoveries are made, how discoveries were made in the Bell Lab, how transistor was discovered in the Bell Lab, how Schottky was very jealous of Bardeen and Bratton, you know, and the moment he came to know that Bardeen has actually discovered the transistor, he went and discovered one himself. You know, they were working together. I said about teamwork. He made sure that his discovery goes above these fellows. So even today it is known as Schottky, Bardeen and Bratton. Of course, it's a different matter. That story has to be completed in this story, which is that Bardeen went to get the Nobel Prize. All of them went. Bardeen went to get the Nobel Prize, and the Swedish king asked him, "Where is your wife? You have not brought her." And Bardeen, without batting an eyelid, said, "I will bring her the next time." Okay. And he went for the second Nobel Prize, he went with his wife and children. Okay, so that is Bardeen. And Bardeen is even further ahead. After all, humility we are talking about. Bardeen had a partner in tennis. They were partners for 30 years. And the partner did not know what Bardeen was doing. So one day, some 30 years later, he asked Bardeen, "What do you do for a living?" "Oh, khane pine ke liye kya karte ho?" He bola ki main professor banta hu. Chota in college mein professor hu. He didn't say that he had won two Nobel Prizes. So that was Bardeen, and this was shocking. Okay, no wonder Bardeen died a happy death. But Schottky was berated, he made all kinds of statements about eugenics. He said that blacks are much less intelligent than the whites. And so he was thrown out of the labs. And then, okay, he also said that women cannot do mathematics. Do you believe that? Okay, I have a daughter who has done two PhDs, and one of them is in applied mathematics. the other is in physics. So, so Shockey got what he deserved for them. So, continued 1980s, auto radar, 77 gigahertz, MMIC chips, now commercial products from 18 to 77, satellite communication through 22 gigahertz, 60 gigahertz. Hottest topic of today in communications is 5G, as you all know, and its impact. It is fully in the millimeter wave region when Sir J.C. Bose had discovered. So, J.C. Bose's contribution is simply immense. No? It cannot be counted in terms of Nobel Prize and all that. This is like asking why Mahatma Gandhi didn't get the Nobel Prize. To hell with the Nobel Prize. Okay. And not given. Not given. So anyways, let us come to our things. So microstrip antennas and arrays were developed, numerical techniques, NEC, numerical electromagnetic code, HFSS, CST, all these things, making it easier to design antennas and reduce costs for mobile communication, smart and adaptive antennas, and MEM have been designed, reconfigurable antennas on which she is working, has been being developed. And we now move on to the subject of radio astronomy, where some of these things are being used. Okay, because this is the only jump which I know of, which was truly indigenous. Okay, after J.C. Bose, S.K. Mitra made a big contribution to ionosphere and all that. But truly, what has been taken forward is in radio astronomy by Professor Gonzo, who is a student of Allahabad University, who studied under Dr. K.S. Krishnan, Mithila, and he did an enormous contribution like J.C. Bose. J.C. Bose appeared to have lost interest in millimeter and microwave work by 1910 and moved to blank physics, because actually what happened was that Jagdish Bose was working with these coherers, what were called the spin coherers. And he found that they were to become decoherent. He had to apply a reverse voltage and all that. And then slowly he started thinking that inanimate objects also have a certain life in them. And he set out to prove that. And that is how he got into plant physiology. He wanted to prove that plants also are living. They are not something inanimate. They can feel pain, they can feel shock, and they can feel joy and things like that. So he combined his spiritualism with physics and biology and got into plant physiology. But many of the statements which he made were right, many statements were wrong, and there was no critical appreciation of those things. And today we know much better about those things. But at the time, a lot of plant physiologists in Europe, they were dead set against J.C. Bose, and that is why his career sort of dimmed down towards the end. But he carried on with this, but the other problem with J.C. Bose, as I understood, was that he did not leave a great school behind him. Okay, probably he was not a teacher as such, or he did not get interested after 1910 or 1915, unlike Raman left a school at least behind him.
S.M.
Bose was his student, S.K. Mitra was his student, Meghnad Saha was his student. Okay, so I knew S.M. Bose incidentally.
But in microwave, actually, Meghnad Saha was in microwave.
Yeah, but he didn't, he went to physics again. So they didn't go to the applied parts of. Applied parts of microwaves. So that is why. So the radio science in India has been rapid in post-independence period, particularly in the field of radio astronomy. And Professor Gonzo, who left Stanford to come to India in 1963, he built up a great big school today, which is flourishing. And I have been a close associate of Gonzo for now 50 years almost. Okay, and so radio astronomy is a huge subject by itself. I will not go into the details of that. Non-thermal processes like quasars and radio galaxies, pulsars and masers. Radio astronomy is the one which discovered that in the center of what appears to be a galaxy, there are accreting objects which are in an intense state of plasma, and they are emitting plasma beams, and these plasma beams cover the entire electromagnetic spectrum. Okay, and these plasma beams are sustained over a million to 100 million light years. Okay, and look at this example of this. This is the Cygnus galaxy. From here, there is a beam of light which is going, and which has been there for 100 million years. And it is spewing out plasma, and which can be detected by radio astronomy antennas. Radio antennas in millimeter wave, in microwaves, in radio waves, in decameter waves, all. So these are very interesting things. Non-thermal processes, so we can go. We can use very high angular resolution today of micro arc seconds, and we can start looking at the centers of these objects. We can look at this and then get this, and then look at this and get this, and look at this and get this. So we can really go very close to the central object, which is a quasar, which is also an accreting black hole. Okay. So that is how the discoveries in radio astronomy is going ahead these days, by using the fundamental principles of antennas and receivers and detectors. Okay, so this is all sort of derivation and going away from decibels, but that's what we are doing these days. And these are the traces of cosmic magnetic fields. The entire cosmos is just covered with currents. Not only voltages, you know, it's unbelievable. But there are thousands of amperes flowing in the cosmic space, which are very fiber-like things, and they are just covering all this huge area it is covering. There are plasma beams going out, but this whole thing is covered with cosmic magnetism, and people are trying to discover this cosmic magnetism at various frequencies. And today, radio astronomy is progressing tremendously. Several Nobel Prizes have come already in these areas. Okay, of that of Tony Kuhn, Martin Ryle, and Chandrasekhar for the black hole, and for Joseph Taylor for pulsars, and so on and so on. So many Nobel Prizes have come, so these areas have become extremely important. So these are all the magnetic fields in the galaxies and intergalactic space. This is a total galaxy, this is a spiral arm of the galaxy, and interstitial magnetic fields are there all over the place. And so discovery of these things are being made by low frequency antennas again. But for ourselves, we had to make a beginning. So we made a beginning in 1960s. I was a student like you when I joined Ground Group in 1966. And we started building antennas. First antenna which we built was near Bombay in Kalyan. And this was an array which was sort of, we got it from Australia and we set it up there. But then we jumped from here to something far bigger. Which is called now the UT telescope. UT telescope was commissioned in 1970. I was one of the guys who built the UT telescope. Once upon a time, I used to say, you tell me any bolt and nut of this telescope, I can tell you what it is and who put it there and how it was put. So he did so much of work. It was all done by a set of graduate students. Basically, some dozen graduate students who were doing PhD. They built this telescope along with mechanical engineers, technical assistants, and all these fellows. And they've been working ever since. They're working and making great discoveries. A radio telescope, for those of you who have not thought about it, is simply a radio receiver. It has an antenna like this, a parabolic reflector, and you receive the parabolic reflector, the electromagnetic waves which follow this, into a prime focus here, maybe a dipole, a simple dipole, and from that you bring the voltages and you amplify the voltages, and then you take it to a detector and you record. So it is not very dissimilar to the transmitter and receiver of AC Bose. And that's what this also does. But this is the advantage, there is a huge collecting area. It is half a kilometer long and 30 meters wide. It's a huge envelope. Okay? And the whole thing rotates. So marvelous thing to go and see. And then building it, huge stories I will tell you, how difficult it was to. So the only story which I will tell you was, that was being built by Bridge and Roof engineers called Bridge and Roof Company. It was based in Kolkata. Okay. And so the chief engineer of this project came from Bridge and Roof. So he came to me, I was only 23 years old or something like that. So he came and said that, sir, he was addressing me as sir. Because I was a scientist, so he was thinking that it must be a good thing. So he told me that, sir, we know only how to make boilers. Look, big, huge. All accuracy is 1 foot. Okay. You are asking for accuracy of few millimeters. I don't know anything about few millimeters. I cannot make a huge structure which is few millimeter accurate. He said 6 millimeter accuracy is what we will accept. Okay, because we were working at 92 centimeter regular, but we wanted an accuracy, surface accuracy of a few millimeters. So we finally accepted 10 millimeters. But he had tremendous difficulty in that space of producing a surface which was how to measure a large structure, a 30 meter structure, and you say, made a few millimeters. You don't have theodolite, the theodolites were a very poor quality. So we had to devise various internal devices and ingenious devices we had to measure to make measurement of it. So if you take a large structure and if you lift it, you know what happens. What happens? A large structure you lift, what happens? It sags by self-weight. Okay. So you need to make a structure which does not sag. So you have to put struts in the structure in the appropriate places so that the sagging is completely counterbalanced. So these things had to be done, these things had to be invented. So I had no idea of any of these things. But I had to sit down and become a mechanical engineer. Because of this, I became a mechanical engineer, electrical engineer, no engineer. Finally. So this is how we built this, but it has been an extremely successful telescope. It has discovered many, many quasars and objects, and it is still used for seeing how the sun spews out radiation and so on. And this is the only telescope, but I have to tell you the trick by which this has been built. As you can see, this is on a slope of a hill. Slope of a hill looks like this. Okay, and this is the sunlight falling on the telescope reflecting wires, and that is the reflecting wires which reflect radio waves onto the dipoles which are located at the prime focus here. And this is built in a very ingenious fashion. Now that is the Earth, and this is the latitude of that place, 11 degrees. And we found a hill which was, we found a hill like this, which made it more or less parallel to the axis of the Earth. The Earth's axis is this parallel line. And we put the telescope this way. So, the rotating axis of the telescope became parallel to the Earth's axis. So, as the Earth rotates, if you counter rotate, then any star which rises in the east will simply remain on the telescope's beam. Because we have taken care of the rotation of the Earth. Okay. And since the Earth rotates from west to east, not from east to west to east, so you have to rotate the telescope from east to west. So once the star is located, or once the radio object is located on the beam of the telescope, then if you simply rotate the telescope, it will stay on the beam for the next 10 hours since the radio source sets below the sky, western sky. So you get a huge amount of time over which you can observe this object. And with this large collecting area, if you observe such objects, you can actually put all the data together. And so you can really see very weak objects. It is like finding a camera and just keeping it fixed and just receiving light. Okay? So you can gather a huge quantity of light and you can make images out of it. So you can get what is called an excellent signal to noise ratio. So basically, it is a question of increasing the signal to noise ratio of these. So, this is what, so to get the arc second resolutions, radio astronomers need a radio telescope which is a few hundred kilometers in diameter. Since this is not practical, the principle of radio interferometry is used, which is analogous to Michelson's optical interferometry. And this is another one which got a Nobel Prize for a man, for a very simple idea. That all that he said was the Earth rotates. And he got a Nobel Prize for that. But that is not possible, right? So what he said was that as the Earth rotates, two antennas which are, two antennas which are like this, as the Earth rotates, now you see two, right? So if you rotate, now you see what? Only one. That's what happens. So the projected baseline, what is called the projected distance between these two, it shortens. Okay? As a function of the angle of rotation. Now what does that mean? That means that in interferometry, Michelson's interferometry, if you have learned basic physics, somewhere, it says that the angular resolution is wavelength divided by the aperture. Okay? The aperture is the distance between the two lenses. Okay? So this aperture goes on shrinking. Therefore, the angular resolution goes on changing. So it is like a variable aperture camera. So you can make images of large objects, small objects. So you can, produce aperture synthesis. Aperture synthesis lies at the bottom of all kinds of antenna configurations today. Okay. When we say phased array radar, what is this phased array? It is this. You actually are phasing the difference in the arrival of the wave between two antennas. Okay? So this is a very fundamental principle. So Weil said, without bothering about anything, because the Earth rotates, I can make this aperture change everyday basis. So I can have what is called Earth rotation aperture synthesis. That is his Nobel Prize. Okay, very simple to understand. But as a result, he was able to make an image of the Cygnus galaxy, which was first seen by Professor Manal Dasgupta, who was my teacher in radio physics in Kolkata. He was the first one who did the aperture synthesis, but Weil improved upon it tremendously. And it was not Dasgupta who got the Nobel Prize, but it was pardoned by Dr. Gupta. Okay, but of course, pardoned by was a great physicist and engineer. And so each pair of antennas functions like a Young's double slit, multiplying the sky brightness distribution by a sinusoidal response function, and therefore an interferometer measures one Fourier component of the radio image. So I will not go into the any of the details. This is the only equation which I have written. This is a dead talk. So you can synthesize the sine component and the cosine component and the sine component, and you can produce a signal in real channel as a complex visibility function, and this can be used to produce a 2D, two-dimensional Fourier transform of the brightness distribution of the image, and you can make a radio camera in the sky. And this is the radio camera which is being used left and right. Even for Mangalyaan, we will have to use that camera, such a camera, if you want to really get to very high resolution of a few meters. If you want to see how the Mangalyaan drops down, which has been already done in Titan, in Jovian atmosphere, by a Russian interferometer, this can be done. So on. Okay. So the bright, this was Mrinal Das Gupta's picture, and Ryle did this. This is Martin Ryle, and Martin Ryle produced a picture like this, and that, there lies his fame. So once I was visiting Cambridge, and Professor Hughes, who is a colleague of Martin Ryle, and who got the Nobel Prize, and he was my external examiner, he said, hey, come, I'll show you something. And he showed me the first pictures of this. And he said that now that this has been done, then we don't have to bother now. Now you can do all your derivation. So both Martin Ryle and Hughes, they got the Nobel Prize in 1975 for discovery of this as well as for pulsars. And the extension of that is the very large array in New Mexico, where the antennas are spanning. Actually, this is a contracted image. They are spanning some 21 kilometers or so. Okay. And what we have produced is very similar. We have produced something. Oh, this is the picture finally which came. This was the VLA radio image of the CMSA. The super imaging by VLA showed how the radio lobes are powered by jets and high energy particles. So physics came out of all this. Currently, one of the largest and most sensitive radio telescopes in the world is in India, namely the giant middle-wave radio telescope. It has about 30,000 square meters of effective collecting area. Due to lack of time, I will not go into the detail, but I will urge you to make a visit to GMRB and spend a day understanding the work being done there. This is GMRB. This is very similar to the VLA, very large array which you saw. Okay, it's an array which spans roughly a Y shape, and which we built again indigenously at a very low cost. It cost us only about 50 crores or so in 1992 or 1994, and today, of course, it will cost 2,000 crores probably. But it is one of the most modern radio arrays in the world, and now people are trying to use. Even NASA is asking it to be used for detection of things which are very far away, objects going. So I won't go into the details of this. This is a marvelous thing which has been actually built in India by Indian labor, by simple Indian labor. Unbelievable if it has not been described. This whole structure was lifted by hand. It's a 12 meter, this is a 100 ton structure. It's all lifted using the ancient pulley methods. Pulleys were attached to this whole structure. The structure was sitting there. I had a video, but I couldn't bring it down to show you how the structure was raised and attached and became a rotating structure. This is a fully steerable antenna. It rotates more than 360 degrees. And it also rotates 90 degrees. So it can cover all parts of the sky at sufficient speeds, and so it can track any object in the sky which is visible in the Pune horizon. This is close to Pune city. It's about 80 kilometers from Pune. And this is a very heavily used 24/7 instrument. And being heavily used by at least some 50 or 60 countries in the world. Everybody comes and uses. So we have gone one step ahead of JC Bose. And at least what we have built is being used heavily by everybody. We also don't charge anybody any money. Okay. It's free of cost. And he can tell you more because he was there for 1 year. He was there. So he can tell you more about it. So we, in fact, one of my students did this work some 10 years ago. That's the only one which I could pull out. Detailed radio maps from GMRB can be compared to optical images of the same objects to get complementary information about the source. So these are the things. So now, what is the next big advance that we can make? The next big advance which is being made is what is called the square kilometer array, which has got a million square meter of collecting area. This is a continent-sized radio telescope, which is spanning the continent of Africa as well as that of Australia. Okay, having about 3,000 antennas of 12 meter diameter, all of them combined by optical fiber, and getting data at exabyte rates. Okay, no computer in the world can manage that at the moment. The data will be coming to that new telescope, whose picture is not here, is something like some 100 petabytes or something like that. So it's very difficult to store such data. So computers are being built for that purpose now, because it is super, super great computers. So these blue gene or something like that, HP and GE and all these fellows, IBM, they are all working together now. And India is part of that. India is one of the 10 or 12 countries which is contributing monetarily as well as in terms of software and hardware. And so that is why I made a statement right at the beginning that today it is only cheap work which will produce any result. Because science has grown so much, technology has grown so much, that no individual can possibly do such things in his mind. So since time is getting, so we will, you want me to close this? Because there is too much ahead. So this is, anyway, in terms of sensitivity, I will finish this one. In terms of sensitivity, as years pass by, we are going steadily down. So we are able to go down to very small amount of power from cosmos we are able to receive. Now it is in terms of 0.001 millijansky. Millijansky. Jansky is a unit after the discoverer of radio window called Jansky. And it is 10 to the power of minus 26 watts per meter squared per hertz. Okay. So it is an extremely small number. But now we are going towards micro Janskys, which means 10 to the power of minus 30 watts, minus 32 watts. So we can detect. So where have we got? From 1900 in 2018. We have gone down to by that order also. So we can now detect very, very, very small signals. So the detector technology has tremendously improved. And so these are being extended. So millimeter waves also have progressed tremendously because of radio astronomy. The lack of sophisticated electronics required for front and back ends for such short wavelengths hindered progress, but with the advent of SIS mixers and other state-of-the-art devices, millimeter wave astronomy has come and its own. While many millimeter wave telescopes have been built during the past 30 years, what is called the Atacama Large Millimeter Wave Array is the one which is now by a consortium of countries in North America, Europe and Asia. It has been built, which is currently the most advanced instrument in millimeter and submillimeter wavelength. It's a beautiful instrument at 15,000 feet altitude in Chilean Andes. And this is now looking at the sky using millimeter wavelength and using components which were originally thought about by J.C. Rose. That is the connection. Okay, and so this is, I don't have time to talk about all these things, so I will skip that. We also tried to make a millimeter wave telescope in Bangalore in C.V. Raman's institute. That has been now dismantled, but we have a huge problem that millimeter wave components are extremely expensive. And we don't make them indigenously. So unless we learn to make them indigenously, these costs are not going to come down. And only by that we can make these devices at a low enough cost for doing research in India. Otherwise we'll keep on buying these equipments from abroad, and that's why it will be a problem. But millimeter waves are currently being used in telecommunications. In large scale, US government has given 13 gigahertz of spectrum in the 7-95 gigahertz of range for directional point-to-point last mile links. If these could be effectively used, one can have wireless USB and a wireless fiber as compared to integrated 2.11G of 54 MBS. This technology offers a much larger speed. So, this is how the science and technology are progressing, and the next stage is even worse than this, that is from 100 gigahertz to 30 terahertz. So this I will completely skip. I will only tell you that that is the last frontier that we will be going towards. Okay, this is terahertz window, which is being shown here. This is what will stop, because after that is all visible and X-ray and MRIs. So this terahertz window is the future window, and people are heading towards that, and this requires development of even oscillators and amplifiers and receivers, which are currently extremely expensive. They are in the hundreds of gigahertz to thousands of gigahertz range. And so this is an extremely exciting topic, selected as one of the 10 emerging technologies that will change the world, because there is a huge bandwidth there, and therefore in terms of frequency, when you go to 300 gigahertz or higher, it is really broadband, and that's what we need for going to 6G and 7G and all that. So if you want to reach that stage where you want data and video and voice anywhere and everywhere for anybody and everybody, that is the slogan which is now being talked about, then you really need bandwidth. And there will be much, much, much bigger scams than 2G scams. Okay, 2G scam was nothing. Because here we are talking of hundreds of gigahertz. Okay. In fact, a megahertz of spectrum, I think, is today 500 crores or something. So you can imagine in terms of hundreds of gigahertz. So I will not go into any of these details, but terahertz are now being used not only for making the images of leaves and other things, but are also being used for detecting concealed objects. They are being already employed. If you go to United States, if you are trying to get out of United States, then they scan you. They don't scan you with all the usual scanning machines which we use here. They all become surveillance, infrared surveillance. So it has become terahertz surveillance. So through terahertz, they can detect both non-metal and metal objects concealed under the clothing. It can be imaged, and high throughput screening is got. And in terms of detection, coherent terahertz waves are detected by mapping both the amplitude and phase of a transient electric field. All these are basic electromagnetic theory. There's no change. Okay, except that these are becoming more and more sophisticated. Unfortunately, in India, very little work is being done yet. Professor Bose would have been very excited if you know about this. So this is how it is being done. So you can detect guns which are kept here, and so you can detect these things. A 3D image can be made, and so these things will come up. So one of our people, Gautam Chattopadhyay, is working on trials in JPL quite intensively. And so these things can be detected now. And so there are lots of challenges because we need many photo detectors, amplifiers, incoherent versus coherent detection, heterodyning, direct amplification. Everything that was done at low frequencies has to be done now at extremely high frequencies. So it is becoming very important. But future looks very bright for this area of R&D. So we come to the summary. Jagdish Chandra Bose was a truly outstanding experimental scientist of India who discovered millimeter wave transmission. He was well ahead of his time, hence did not attract the kind of attention that he deserved. Great son of India, deserved a Nobel Prize. Science icon, with a special place in advancement of modern science and technology in India. But we have done remarkably well today, thanks to Professor Goldsroom's effort in meter wavelength radio astronomy in India by building the Lucky and JMRT telescope. But we have not been successful in developing millimeter and sub-millimeter wave astronomy to a higher level. These are very interesting and specialized areas and require a good understanding of physics and electromagnetics. So, but modern developments in antenna, electronics and communications make these very challenging and exciting fields. The use of millimeter waves, sub-millimeter, terahertz waves in civil, medical, military is becoming extensive and offers great career prospects for those that get into it. I encourage youngsters here to think about these exciting areas of R&D and innovate and pay homage to the great scientists. So thank you very much.
No problem. So thank you, Professor Ananthakrishnan, for the wonderful talk. So may I just take some two or three quick questions? Yes.
How can we visit the GMRT?
Oh, that's right. There is a website. Go to www.ncra. Hold on, okay. ncra.tafr.res.in. But just go to this GMRT, okay? That will give you the site. And then there is a form there saying that I want to visit GMRT. I think they allow visitors on Friday. Okay. Or if you make a special visit for a group of students or something like that, then somebody will take you along and spend time.
Yes,
of course, of course.
No permission.
Yeah, no permission.
One can simply go there and.
Yeah, of course.
One or two quick questions.
Was it too boring?
Please ask some.
Yes. You take the reflector receiver only for millimeter waves or for other frequency also?
No, the problem which you should realize is that as the wavelength changes, the technique changes. Okay. You cannot use the same devices that you use. You need an SAS mixer for very high frequencies, not the ordinary mixer. It will not work. You need a different kind of amplifier. A 200 GHz amplifier is quite different from 30 MHz amplifier. Okay, the normal FETs will not work.
If we compare those results, means like for a star cluster, if we take for millimeter wave data and gamma wave data,
that's a good question. It is like a blind man talking about an elephant. The four blind men and the elephant story. You see certain parts of it. You don't see certain other parts of it, in the sense that if you go towards the Perovskite region, then you will see the hot plasma which is there. So in fact, that is what is used for discovering how the stars are born. And then what happens is that they are spewing out energy, so they start losing energy. So by the time they come to very low frequency radio waves, you have got what are called tired electrons. The electrons have become tired by just radiating. They have been radiating and losing energy, so H nu comes down. Since H is constant, the nu is becoming smaller and smaller. So it goes from gamma ray to low radio frequency. So you have to use different techniques to find them. So that is why you have to use radio telescopes at meter wavelengths, centimeter wavelengths, millimeter wavelengths, and then optical wavelengths, then gamma rays, X-rays and gamma rays, ultraviolet, like the astrosat.
Of oxygen and water molecules.
Yeah.
That makes it difficult. So are we working with area of space and astronomy at millimeter
wave? Yeah. We are, but obviously, as you say, you have to bypass this. How do we bypass this? There's only one way. You go up the atmosphere. So for big ground telescopes, people have gone to 15,000 feet, 5,000 meters. Now more than that, if you start going, first of all, you can't live there. Okay, all of us will start dying. So there is a limit to how much you can go. Okay, as you know, climbing Everest is not easy. And there are no flat ground. So Chilean Andes is a very good place. Himalayas is also there. But the Himalayas are less accessible than the Chilean Andes. So people have found, besides that, India and China are looking like this. Okay, Chinese are spying on us and we are spying on them. And Doklam like crisis is going all the time. So it is not a safe place to go. So that is why people are not developing in the Himalayas as much as they are developing in places like Chilean Andes. So that is about the atmosphere, 5,000 meters, 5 kilometers is where you can go. And beyond that, if you want to go on, you have to send satellites. So many satellites are being sent. Compton Gamma Ray Observatory is there. So millimeter wave, the resolution is not sufficient. You need large ground arrays. That is why millimeter wave telescope, Atacama millimeter wave telescope has been developed. ALMA. Okay? Which has pretty high resolution. About 2 kilometers wavelength. Lambda is a few millimeters. And baseline is a few kilometers, several kilometers. So obviously you get very small fractions of micro radians you get annual resolution.
So let us thank Professor Ananthakrishnan once again for this. IEEE Microwave Society Student Club chapter as well as IEEE Photonics Society Student Club chapter. May I invite Professor S.P. Singh to
Oh, thank you. Thank you. Well, very nice. Thank you so much. Thank you.